Hello there, and welcome to Shots in the Quark. In this episode, we're going to be talking about one of the most shocking features of Einstein's relativity, but one that's often overlooked. You may have seen in other videos a similar thought experiment to the one we'll be describing today, but these other videos rarely seem to emphasize its truly bizarre consequences. If you know anything about relativity, you've probably come across ideas such as the constancy of the speed of light, time dilation, where time slows down based on how fast an object is moving, or the famous relationship between energy and mass, E equals mc squared. These are all fantastically mind-bending and revolutionary ideas, but there's one consequence of relativity above all the others that completely shatters an aspect of our experience that we take for granted, the existence of a now. Suppose you witness two events occur at the same time in different locations. The doorbell rings precisely at the moment you're about to sit down to eat your dinner. When two events occur at the same time, we say that those events are simultaneous. The ringing of the doorbell and your sitting down to eat your dinner are simultaneous events. Now, intuitively, if you witness two events to occur simultaneously, then you'd expect that anyone else you queried would also have witnessed those two events to occur simultaneously. If you asked anyone else in the room whether the doorbell went off at exactly the same time as you sat down, they would agree with you and say yes. Isn't that just common sense? Well, in good old Newtonian physics, this is all true. If two events are simultaneous from your perspective, then everyone else in the universe will also observe those two events to occur simultaneously. Now, if everyone agrees on what events are simultaneous with one another, then it makes sense to talk about a unique, privileged present moment. All the events occurring in the universe right now are those that are simultaneous with the present moment. In Newtonian physics, then, there is a well-defined present and hence a meaningful notion of what time it is now in the universe. How could it be any other way? This is where we encounter our truly shocking feature of relativity theory, the relativity of simultaneity. It's not a very catchy name, but this might explain why it's much less well known than E equals mc squared or time dilation. So what does this clunky phrase relativity of simultaneity mean? We know what simultaneity means. It just refers to the concept of two different events occurring at the same time. But what does the relativity part of it mean? To answer this, let's jump back to some Newtonian physics. In a Newtonian universe, we said that if you observe two events to be simultaneous with one another, then every other observer in that universe will also see those two events as being simultaneous. In Newtonian physics, then, we say that we have absolute simultaneity. There is an absolute fact over whether two events occur at the same time, and every observer in the universe will agree on that fact. Relativity of simultaneity, as opposed to absolute simultaneity, is the negation of this. If simultaneity is relative, we mean that there is no fact over whether two events occur at the same time or not. Different observers may disagree over whether two events occurred simultaneously, and none of them are more correct than the others. This is a crazy result with unbelievable consequences for reality. But before we try and interpret it, let's understand why this happens in relativity. One of the core postulates of special relativity is the light postulate, which says that the speed of light is the same in all inertial reference frames. What does this mean in practice? Imagine that you have a laser source that emits a thin red beam of light. What the light postulate tells you is that no matter how this source is moving, you will always measure the beam it emits to travel at the same speed. The source could be hurtling towards you, away from you, oscillating side to side, but you will always measure the speed of the light that it emits to be the same, c. Sorry to interrupt the video, but hopefully you've noticed a substantial improvement in production quality here at Shots in the Quark. This is all thanks to these guys next to me. It takes a lot of time, effort, and resources from all of us to produce a single video. We love making these videos, and if you'd like to see more like this one, please consider supporting us via our new Patreon. Your support will help us to dedicate more time to improving both the quality and quantity of these videos. And if you do, you'll get access to extra behind-the-scenes content, see upcoming scripts early, and more. So thank you very much for your support. Back to the video. Let's suppose you're standing on the Earth looking up at the night sky, and rushing through the heavens is a rocket ship traveling at half the speed of light. On this ship is your friend, a laser source which fires a laser in two opposite directions, and two bells which will ring if hit by the laser beam. Let's place the two bells at opposite ends of the rocket and position your friend equidistant between them with the laser. When your friend is exactly level with you, they will switch the laser on and two beams of light will fire towards the two bells. We can step onto the rocket and think about what your friend will observe happening. When they switch the laser on, the light postulate dictates that they will see two beams of light traveling towards the two bells at the same speed, c. From their perspective, since the two beams have the same distance to travel and are traveling at the same speed, they will observe the two beams to hit the bells at exactly the same time. They will hear a single chime. In other words, the ringing of the bells to the person on the rocket will be simultaneous. Now, let's consider instead your point of view from the Earth as the rocket is shooting past. When your friend is level with you, they switch the laser on, and from your perspective, the light postulate again demands that the two beams travel at the same speed c, regardless of the fact that the laser is moving. But since the rocket ship is moving, the bell on the left is moving towards the laser at a speed half c, whereas the bell on the right is moving away from it. This means that the beam on the left will take less time to reach its bell than the beam on the right. From your perspective, there won't just be one chime of the bells. You'll hear the left one ringing first, followed by the right one shortly, but distinctly afterwards. In other words, from your perspective, the two events will not be simultaneous. This is truly remarkable. Yet it's a simple consequence of the rules of relativity. From your friend's perspective on the rocket, the two bells ring simultaneously. But from your perspective on Earth, they ring at different times. At this point, you might wonder, sure, I can accept that these two people will disagree over whether the two bells rung simultaneously. But surely we can say that one of them is correct. The person on the rocket, perhaps, is correct that the two bells rung at the same time, and that the person on Earth only disagrees with them because the rocket is moving with respect to them. Unfortunately, we can't. In relativity, all reference frames are equally physically valid. There is no privileged reference frame. This means that in a situation like this, there is no objective answer as to who is right. Relativity entails that simultaneity itself is relative. There is no fact of the matter over whether events happen at the same time. There is no objective now. What does all this tell us about the world? What it tells us is that in relativity, there is no such thing as a unique privileged present. There is no meaningful concept of now in the universe. Because of this, many physicists and philosophers argue that our perception of time is a complete illusion. To us, it may feel like there is a very distinct now, but physics seems to suggest that this is something that our brains have constructed for us. Our subjective experience of a present doesn't correspond to anything physically real. Different people have their own subjective nows, but none of these are more or less physically real than any others. What this implies is that we should see time as less of a pointer highlighting the present moving from past to future, and more that time in some sense exists all at once, the whole length of the timeline existing equally. This is why many physicists talk about viewing time as a fourth dimension and picturing the universe not as a three-dimensional space evolving in time, but as a four-dimensional block of space-time. Instead of there being a well-defined present, all of space and time already exist out there as a four-dimensional block. What we experience as a present is just a particular subjective slicing up of this block. I might slice up the block in a certain way, where each of these slices are my presence, going from the past at the bottom to the future at the top, but someone else moving with respect to me will slice up the block totally differently. Events that exist for me on the same slice, and so will be simultaneous with one another, will not be on the same slice for someone moving with respect to me, and so they will not see these events as being simultaneous. Since the block can be sliced up in different ways by different observers, this suggests that there's not just one slice of it that exists at any one time. In a sense, the whole block must exist all at once. The relativity of simultaneity is one of the simplest yet most remarkable features of relativity, and yet in my experience, one of the lesser known. In this video, we've explored why simultaneity must be relative and the implications this has for our understanding of time. Relativity very strongly suggests that time is not what we thought it was. It's not a strict progression of cause to effect. It's more like a big block of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff that we slice up into our own subjective nows. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed. Please like and subscribe for more Shots in the Quark.